So in tropical countries, which represent the frontiers in the battle between, say, deforestation and climate change versus economic development, it is very difficult to protect forests through monitoring enforcement alone. So these are countries where institutions are not so strong, and it's very difficult to identify culprits and find them and enforce laws. And so governments have taken a more indirect approach of seeing whether we can induce farmers or deforesters to adopt behaviors or technologies and products that are going to be less threatening to the forest. So one approach might be, say, if you were to increase economic productivity of farmers, perhaps they'll need to deforest less, so that they can get more out of existing pieces of land, so that they won't go out and clear new land. So a problem with that approach, where the government's trying to induce farmers to engage in behaviors that are less threatening to the forest, is that if you increase economic productivity, farmers may have exactly the opposite reaction, which is, now that I can get more out of a hectare of land, I should be converting a larger number of hectares from forest and into crop cultivation or cattle grazing. So your policy of improving farming productivity might in fact backfire. So when the government approached us to think about problems where, you know, can we induce farmers to engage in more productive activities, so my worry was that we might actually do more harm to the Amazon rainforest than instead of protecting it. I wanted to first look at the historical data to see if there is anything to this idea of increasing productivity and indirectly protecting the forest. Right? And so we could do this by looking at the census data in Brazil. Brazil is a country that has a very rich history of collecting micro-level data. So they can conduct agricultural censuses where every farmer in the country is surveyed every 5 to 10 years. And through those surveys, we can actually look at land use decisions. So how much land are farmers using for crop cultivation or for cattle grazing or leaving it in native vegetation like forest. And so the way we try and identify how improvement in agricultural productivity might benefit the forest is to look at this history of electrification in Brazil. So over the second half of the 20th century, there was tremendous growth in electrification in Brazil, and a lot of farms got electrified. And this turned out to increase productivity in crop cultivation a lot more than it did in cattle grazing. So in cattle, there's not much use of technology in Brazil. So it's basically, there's no use of confinement, no fencing, and cattle are allowed to roam free. Whereas electricity might be very beneficial for crop cultivation because of the uses of irrigation or uses of refrigeration, et cetera. Okay? So what we observe is, as electricity spread through Brazil, crop cultivation productivity increased a lot more than cattle productivity. So farmers switched into crop cultivation away from cattle. And because cattle is so much more land intensive, this allowed them to actually save a lot more land within their farms in native vegetation. And that's what benefited the forest. Okay? So in this case, increased productivity was actually beneficial to the environment. That wasn't probably the intent of the electrification policy, but it indirectly benefited the environment. Okay? So in terms of policy implications, this means that there is some hope, first, that if we were to increase productivity in the right set of activities, right, that's an indirect way for us to protect the environment and also address the economic needs of farmers. The tie that binds together all of my work, you know, across countries and across sectors, is that it's very, as I started saying, it's very difficult for us to encourage behavior change. So when people are used to doing things a certain way, right, but there might be a more productive or a welfare-improving alternative, right, but that's not the way that people are used to doing things traditionally. It's very difficult to change that behavior, and those are constraints, you know, kind of these behavioral constraints that prevent adoption of new products and techniques. There are some commonalities in those constraints across countries and across sectors, right? So just as one example, in work in which I encourage seasonal migration in Bangladesh away from a famine-prone area, what I find is that when people are extremely poor, they are very risk-averse about trying something new, moving away and trying for a job in a different location, right? So risk aversion seems to be an important driver of behavior or non-change in behavior, especially when people are poor. Okay? Now, it turns out that that same behavioral model can help explain why agricultural technology adoption is low, right? So if I go to a farmer who's been doing, applying the same technique or using the same seed variety year after year, right? And I go in and tell them that here's a new seed variety that we've tested in the lab, and it doubles productivity, or it's a little more drought resistant, right? So that farmer's reaction might be, it's great, I do believe you that in your lab it doubled productivity, but what if it doesn't work given my rainfall conditions, my soil quality, or my farming techniques, right? I cannot take the risk that I have a crop failure, right? So again, for a very different sector in a very different country, you might have the same behavioral mechanism or constraint that's preventing adoption of a very different productive technology. So these are technologies that are more productive and has the potential to increase income, and there's a huge upside. But when people are really poor and they cannot handle their risk, the downside risk, right, then they cannot think about the upside and take advantage of that upside potential, right? It's like you're in a poverty trap where the downside risk, because you cannot manage it, because you don't have insurance, right, that prevents you from concentrating on what the upside potential is, right? And that's what keeps some people poor, because they're not changing behavior to a more productive option, right, just because the downside risk is not covered. So that suggests that policy should really think about insuring the poor. So they don't necessarily only need subsidies, or not even, subsidies may not even be helpful, right? But they might just need a policy that helps cover the downside risk, that, you know, you try out this new technique, if it works, you should pay for it, but if it doesn't work, you know, you're going to be covered. You're going to be no worse off, right? And that's what allows people to experiment with new things and potentially get income growth in the long run.